in the 7th chapter of Luke, beginning with the 36th verse. One of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with them, and he went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And a woman in the city who was a sinner, having learned that Jesus was eating in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster jar of ointment. She stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears and to dry them with her hair. Then she continued kissing his feet and anointing them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee who had invited him saw it, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what kind of woman this is who is touching him, that she is a sinner." Jesus spoke up and said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." "Teacher," he replied, "speak." "A certain creditor had two debtors, one owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debts for both of them. Now which of them will love him more?" Simon answered, "I suppose the one of whom he canceled the greater debt." And Jesus said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has bathed my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore I tell you, her sins, which were many, have been forgiven, and she has shown great love. But the one to whom little is forgiven loves little." Then he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." But those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. By the way, I've never been more proud of you than watching you guys do the storm. That was awesome. You should see it with a chapel full of kids at Luther Park. If you send your kids to Luther Park, you can come and witness it. It'd be pretty cool. Grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Have you ever played the party game, "Who Are You Inviting to Dinner?" You know this game. You pick five people throughout time that you'd be willing, that you would want to come and eat dinner at your house with you for one meal. Five people that you'd want to get to know or learn more about. Most people pick like famous athletes or celebrities, both alive and dead. You know, you might pick somebody like Aaron Rodgers, or Bart Starr, or Abraham Lincoln, or Martin Luther, or me. Me. No, that's not good. You might even pick Jesus, though I'd be a little nervous about that one. So who are you inviting to dinner? Who's coming to your house? Are you going to invite the Mexican immigrant, or the Syrian refugee, or the African-American homeless man that you saw on the streets of Minneapolis? Are you going to invite someone who's protested Donald Trump, or someone who's a hardcore Trump supporter? Are you going to invite that boss that always gave you a hard time and screwed you out of a raise? I'm going to invite the person who first broke your heart and made you doubt your worth. Are you going to invite a Vikings fan or a Bears fan? Are you going to invite a Muslim, a Buddhist, an atheist? Are you going to invite that neighbor with the annoying dog that wakes you up at 4 a.m. every day? Are you going to invite the family member who's turned their back on the family? Who are you going to invite today? We have what's going on in our meeting today, a dinner party, but it is remarkable. And though there's a lot that goes on, the most remarkable remarkable thing occurs in the very first verse. A Pharisee invited Jesus to dinner. Think about that statement. A Pharisee, a keeper of the law, one who has stood as Jesus has taught and criticized his disciples, has criticized his teaching, has started to look for ways to harm Jesus. A Pharisee who sees in Jesus complete blasphemy has invited him to dinner. And Jesus, who has sat there and criticized the Pharisees as well, has heard the criticism, has often fought against the Pharisee, accepts. He accepts. Think about that for a moment. Two enemies, two people on opposite sides of the spectrum, sit down to dinner. Would we do that? When I listed off the things earlier, did you think to yourself, there's no way any, that a lot of those people aren't coming to my house? They're not sitting down at my table? They're not going to eat my dinner? But here, the Pharisee and Jesus sit down for dinner. That's amazing, even before the woman comes in. She comes in, this known sinner, we don't know her name. People say, tradition says it's Mary Magdalene. There's no biblical stuff for that. It's just a woman who's obviously not led the greatest life. And she begins to cry at Jesus' feet. She begins to anoint him. And the Pharisee thinks, he already has a negative view of Jesus. Now he really has a negative. If he knew who she was, he'd throw her out. What if your neighbor invited you to dinner, and you began to have a conversation about all sorts of things, and they said an opinion that you vehemently disagreed with? Would you throw them out? Would you unfriend them on Facebook because of a post? Would you say, I can't be your friend anymore? It's amazing that the Pharisee doesn't throw Jesus out. And then Jesus teaches. He says, basically, I have come to forgive. Even this one, I have come to forgive. And those who much need forgiveness will show great love. Jesus teaches the Pharisees and us that when there is forgiveness, then love follows. Where there is forgiveness, love follows, not only for God, but for each other and for the world. This woman, who the rest of society has rejected, shows great love to Jesus because she needs that forgiveness. And when Jesus gives it to her, she responds in love. We are no different than that woman. We are all sinners, great sinners. And when we come to God's table, we hold forgiveness in our hands. We hold the body and blood of Christ in our hands. We've heard that forgiveness proclaimed already in the service, and we will hear it again as we take the body and blood. And the question is, will we show great love after receiving that forgiveness? Because Christ gives it to you, not because you are perfect, or even that you treat people with love in the world. Christ gives it to you because he loves you and because you need it. Because I need it. And Christ invites all to his table. All who believe that they are receiving the body and blood of Christ, regardless of political opinion, regardless of what team they follow, regardless of their ethnicity or where they have come from, all who come to this table, Jesus says, here. My forgiveness is for you. Your faith has saved you. Your faith has saved you. Maybe what we can take from this story is that when somebody asks us, who are you willing to invite to dinner? Maybe the answer should be everyone. Especially the people we disagree with.
Because if we're going to heal the divisions in our community and in our nation, the only way to do that is to sit down as equals. Not judging the other, but realizing that all are sinners who fall short. All make mistakes. All have opinions based on all sorts of things. If the Pharisee and Jesus, who disagree vehemently, can sit down to dinner, then so can we. Then so can we. We can sit and we can talk and we can learn. And we don't have to agree. I guarantee you that nobody in this room agrees with the next person about everything or anything in some regards. But we are here together because we know that we need the love of Christ. We know that we are sinners who need forgiveness. And we know that when we are forgiven, we can show that love to others by listening, by inviting, by saying that you have worth. You have worth because that's what Christ has said to us. So, who are you going to invite to dinner? No matter who you invite, know that Jesus invites you every single day to sit at his table, to receive his love and forgiveness, to go out into the world to share that love and forgiveness with others. For that we can say, thanks be to God. Amen.